Random House Audiobooks presents N is for Noose by Sue Grafton. Read for you by Judy Kaye.
N is for Noose. Sometimes I think about how odd it would be to catch a glimpse of the future. A quick view of events lying in store for us at some undisclosed date. Suppose we could peer through a tiny peephole in time and chance upon a flash of what was coming up in the years ahead. Some moments we saw would make no sense at all, and some, I suspect, would frighten us beyond endurance. If we knew what was looming, we'd avoid certain choices. Select option B instead of A at the fork in the road. The job, the marriage, the move to a new state, childbirth, the first drink, the elective medical procedure, that long-anticipated ski trip that seemed like such fun until the dark rumble of the avalanche. If we understood the consequences of any given action, we could exercise discretion, thus restructuring our fate. Time, of course, only runs in one direction, and it seems to do so in an orderly progression. Here in the blank and stony present, we're shielded from the knowledge of the dangers that await us, protected from the future horrors through blind innocence. Take the case in point. I was winding my way through the mountains in a cut-rate rental car, heading south on 395 toward the town of Nota Lake, California, where I was going to interview a potential client. The roadway was dry and the view was unobstructed, weather conditions clear. The client's business was unremarkable, at least as far as I could see. I had no idea there was any jeopardy waiting, or I'd have done something else. I'd left Robert Dietz in Carson City, where I'd spent the last 2 weeks playing nurse companion while he recovered from surgery. He'd been scheduled for a knee replacement, and I volunteered to drive him back to Nevada in his snazzy little red Porsche. He'd been staying in my apartment for the 2 previous months, and since our separation was approaching, we tended to avoid discussing anything personal. For the record, my last name is Millhone, first name Kinsey. I'm female, twice divorced, 7 weeks shy of 36, and reasonably fit. I'm a licensed private detective currently residing in Santa Teresa, California, to which I'm attached like a tetherball on a very short cord. Occasionally, business will swing me out to other parts of the country, but I'm basically a small-town Seamus and likely to remain so for life. Dietz's surgery, which was scheduled for the first Monday in March, proceeded uneventfully, so we can skip that part. He was out of the hospital by Friday morning of that week. The ensuing recovery involved a lot of sitting around with his knee wrapped in bandages as thick as a bolster. The first 3 days I did all the cooking, which is to say I made sandwiches, alternating between my famous peanut butter and pickle extravaganza and my much-beloved sliced hot hard-boiled egg confection with tons of Hellman's mayonnaise and salt. By the end of 2 weeks, Dietz could pretty well fend for himself. His stitches were out and he was hobbling around with a cane between bouts of physical therapy. He had a long way to go, but he could drive to his sessions and otherwise seemed able to tend to his own needs. By then, I thought it entirely possible I'd go mad from trailing after him. It was time to hit the road before our togetherness began to chafe. I enjoyed being with him, but I knew my limitations. So there I was, barreling down the highway in search of employment, and not at all fussy about what kind of work I'd take. I wanted distraction. I wanted money, escape, anything to keep my mind off the subject of Robert Dietz. I'm not good at goodbyes. I've suffered way too many in my day, and I don't like the sensation. On the other hand, I'm not that good at relationships. Get close to someone, and next thing you know, you've given them the power to wound, betray, irritate, abandon you, or bore you senseless. My general policy is to keep my distance, thus avoiding a lot of unruly emotion. In psychiatric circles, there are names for people like me. The prospective client I was traveling to meet was a woman named Selma Newquist, whose husband, I was told, had died sometime within the past few weeks. Dietz had done work for this woman in the past, helping her extricate herself from an unsavory first marriage. I didn't get all the details, but he alluded to the fact that the financial goods he'd gotten on the husband had given Selma enough leverage to free herself from the relationship. There'd been a subsequent marriage, and it was this second husband whose death had apparently generated questions his wife wanted answered. She'd called to hire Dietz, but since he was temporarily out of commission, he suggested me. Under ordinary circumstances, I doubted Mrs. Newquist would have considered a PI from the far side of the state, but my trip home was imminent and I was heading in her direction. If she didn't want to hire me, all I'd be out was a 30-minute break in the journey. I reached Nota Lake, population 2,356, elevation 4,312, in slightly more than 3 hours. The town didn't look like much, though the setting was spectacular. Mountains towered on three sides, snow still painting the peaks in thick white against a sky heaped with clouds. I stopped at a service station and picked up a one-page map of the town, which was shaped like a smudge on the eastern edge of Nota Lake. The prime businesses seemed to be clustered along the main street in a five-block radius. I did a cursory driving tour, counting 10 gas stations and 22 motels. The address I'd been given was on the outskirts of town, two blocks off the main highway, in a cluster of houses that looked like they'd been built by the same developer. The streets in the area were named for various Indian tribes. Selma Newquist lived on a cul-de-sac called Pawnee Way, the house a replica of its neighbors, frame siding, a shake roof with a screened-in porch on one end, and a two-car garage on the other. I parked in the driveway beside a dark Ford sedan. I locked the car from habit, climbed the two porch steps, and rang the bell. The woman who came to the door was in her late 40s with a small, compact body, brown eyes, and short, dark, tousled hair. She was wearing a red, blue, and yellow plaid blouse over a yellow pleated skirt. "Hi, I'm Kinsey Millhone. Are you Selma?" "No, I'm not. I'm her sister-in-law, Phyllis. My husband, Macon, was Tom's younger brother. We live two doors down. Can I help you?"
"I'm supposed to meet with Selma. I should have called first. Is she here?"
"Oh, sorry. I remember now. She's lying down at the moment, but she told me she thought you'd be stopping by. You're that friend of the detective she called in Carson City."
"Exactly," I said. "How's she doing?"
"Selma has her bad days, and I'm afraid this is one. Tom passed away 6 weeks ago today, and she called me in tears. I came over as quick as I could. She was shaking and upset. I gave her a Valium."
"I can come back later if you think that's best."
"No, no, I'm sure she's awake, and I know she wants to see you. Why don't you come on in?"
"Thanks." I followed Phyllis across the entrance and down a carpeted hallway to the master bedroom. In passing, I allowed myself a quick glance into doorways on either side of the hall, garnering an impression of wildly over-decorated rooms. Phyllis knocked on the door.
"Selma, hon, are you decent? It's this lady detective from Carson City."
I started to correct her and then thought better of it. I wasn't from Carson City, and I certainly wasn't a lady, but then what difference did it make? Through the opening, I caught a brief impression of the woman in bed. A pile of platinum blonde hair framed by the uprights on a four-poster. Apparently, I'd been invited in because Phyllis stepped back, murmuring to me as I passed,
"I have to get on home, but you're welcome to call me if you need anything."
I nodded my thanks as I moved into the bedroom and closed the door behind me. I said, "Sorry to disturb you, but Phyllis said it would be okay. I'm Kinsey Millhone." Selma Newquist, in a faded flannel nightie, pulled herself into a sitting position and straightened the covers, reminding me of an invalid ready to accept a bed tray. I estimated her age on the high side of 50, judging by the backs of her hands, which were freckled with liver spots and ropey with veins. Her skin tone suggested dark coloring, but her hair was a confection of white blonde curls like a cloud of cotton candy. She reached for her cigarettes, groping on the bed table until she had both the cigarette pack and lighter. Her hand trembled slightly as she lit her cigarette.
"Why don't you come over here?" she said. She gestured toward a chair. "Push that off there and sit down where I can see you better."
I moved her quilted robe from the chair and placed it on the bed, pulling the chair in close before I took a seat. She stared at me, puffy-eyed, a thin stream of smoke escaping as she spoke.
"I'm sorry you had to see me this way. Ordinarily, I'm up and about at this hour, but this has been a hard day."
"I understand," I said. Smoke began to settle over me like the fine spray from someone's sneeze.
Did Robert Dietz tell you about Tom?
Only that you were recently widowed. That's as much as I know.
I'll fill you in then, though I'm really not sure where to start.
You may think I'm crazy, but I assure you I'm not. She took a puff of her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.